Now let's dive into the presidential stuff. You reminded me, you just talked about the men and women and the provision of freedom based on their sacrifice. I don't know if you've heard the audio or not, but earlier today, our friend Timothy Geithner said that wealthy people should pay more taxes because of the privilege of being an American.
Let's call a spade. I mean, the entire current administration under the America-hating Barack Obama and the American-hating Joe Biden and the American Constitution criminal Eric Holder, Tim Geithner is a perfect example of what the current American government stinks like, because Tim Geithner is a tax cheat. Tim Geithner was caught not paying his taxes. So instead of being in jail, Tim Geithner, the tax cheat, is actually in charge of the economy, of our financial system. Are you kidding me? Why don't we just hire Jeffrey Dahmer to be in charge of the children's playground? I mean, this whole administration is so corrupt, it abuses power like no one in the history of the United States of America has ever done, and Tim Geithner is a poster child, just like Eric Holder, running guns to the Mexican drug gangs. Are you kidding me? Can it get crazier? Can it get more criminals than this? We have criminals. We have American-hating maniacs in our government. And Tim Geithner's latest nonsense is a perfect example of that.
So what do these candidates need to do? Because it doesn't seem like the four candidates that are still left on the Republican side of the aisle have been able to, in polls, come out ahead. And I know polling data is going to change, but what do you need to hear from one of these four guys, whoever the one is that comes out as the nominee? What needs to be said to the American people to convince them to make a change in November?
Well, number one, if we listen closely to the four Republican candidates, I have great admiration in varying degrees for each and every one of them. Each and every one of these candidates have some really, really quality positive points about them, and each one of them would make a vastly superior president of the United States than the current mess that we're in right now. That should be perfectly clear to anybody with a brain. But ultimately, these guys got to go down to the Army Navy surplus store and buy themselves a box of scrotums. They got to get some balls. They got to get tough, condemning the current self-inflicted tailspin of the Obama administration, literally following the Cloward pivot and the Saul Alinsky playbook on how to destroy America, how to destroy freedom, how to destroy capitalism, how to literally condemn being the best that you can be while they reward people for being the worst that they can be. These four presidential candidates have to get a little tougher, a little bit more fist-pounding on the bully pulpit, and identify the curse, the abject curse that is the United States government, the way it stands right now in the hands of Barack Hussein Obama and Eric Holder et al. So I admire these four Republican candidates, but until they show some real balls and some real adamancy, I don't think they're going to get the momentum they're going to need.
And see, I agree with you. I think there's been a lot of fighting back and forth, and I understand that in a primary. You want to show how you're different from your opponents. But I just think there is so much low-hanging fruit when it comes to this administration, especially now with its foreign policy and the Iranians and apologizing to Afghanistan. But now the gas prices looking like they're getting close to $4, maybe going to $5 a gallon. Why they're not going after this low-hanging fruit of the ridiculous policies of this administration?
Yeah, speaking of ridiculous policies, anti-American policy, this current anti-American monster in the White House, this administration is blatant and flagrantly abusing the Constitution, violating the Constitution, and continuing on a death march for America. So yeah, the four candidates, not just low-hanging fruit, Mike, is literally squashed, rotten fruit that has fallen on the ground, and anybody with a speck of brain or conscientiousness just has to reach down and pick up this bad fruit and expose it to the people that it's rotten, it's maggot-infested, and we need to quit with this stuff and start going for the best fruit we can, which comes straight from the United States Constitution.
Now, I know that you are a family guy. I know that that's very important to you. Give me a couple of things that are most important when you're looking. I'm not going to ask you to endorse a candidate with the four that are left, but what do you want? What is it about one of these guys that's going to lean you toward them? What is going to be a deal maker for you, for the guy you want to see come out of this ahead?
to, number one, maximize the strength of the United States military and the posture that we will take no crap, that we send a message to our allies and our enemies that we will never, ever expose ourselves to the conditions that brought about 9/11 by showing weakness, by not sharing the maximum intelligence and putting it to work every day and letting the heroes of the various agencies, because there are still heroes in those federal agencies, and the ones that blow whistles and the ones that raise hell are the ones that we've got to listen to. So number one, national defense. Number two, the entire welfare program is slavery. We're literally enslaving people to feed off of a government and rewarding people to be the worst that they can be, to not try something, get rid of this embarrassment that there's a list of jobs Americans aren't willing to do. Are you kidding me? How about the condition where Americans have actually given up looking for work? That is so embarrassing. Why don't these people just move to France? So number one, national security, rewarding the productive and punishing the non-productive, because if you are non-productive, you chose to be non-productive. This is the kind of old guard American attitude of being the best, not accepting the worst, and, you know, helping people out, but not letting FedZilla help people out, because FedZilla can't help people out. FedZilla just teaches people to be dependent, and that's a soulless condition. And ultimately, the government should get the hell out of our personal lives. We should get back to the basics of the United States Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and not be reinterpreting things. The right to keep and bear arms means I get to keep it. You can't have it. And bear arms means I've got some on me right now. We got to get back to the basics. And when the basics are returned to, that candidate will win.
Okay. Now, last question for you. You said earlier you're 63 years old, and you don't show any signs to me of slowing down. Are you going to retire at some point? Are you ever going to give up performing live?
I can't imagine. You know, I'm a lucky man. I can still dance like a Motown review, baby. And as long as I've got my health and as long as I maximize my priorities and balance my life between my family's needs and my personal needs, i.e. the hunting season, as long as I can balance out the recharging of my spirit and my soul and my energy, I'll continue to do what I do every day. You know, Mike, every day I get up, I am 63 now. I got two real bad knees. I have to have both of my knees replaced. But I thank God every day I wake up in America and that brave heroes of the U.S. military are willing to sacrifice everything so that I can live by the U.S. Constitution, being the best that I can be. That's so simple. It's bizarre that this president is against those basic American ways. So, yeah, I'll keep going as long as I can, as long as people keep showing up to my concerts and I keep being surrounded by the world's greatest musicians. My music has a life of its own. It's a force to reckon with, and I celebrate that every day. And I also put my heart and soul into being the best that I can be, so I attract these incredible musicians, so that people come to a Ted Nugent concert and they go, oh my God, what? Because the music is so intense, it's the soundtrack for defiance and freedom and rugged individualism. As long as that inspires me every day, I can't be stopped. Write that down.
One last question. I said that was my last one, but you just reminded me of something. If you're going to tour with Styx and REO Speedwagon, if you're going to be with Styx, are we going to hear any damn Yankee stuff?
Boy, would that be wonderful. I would love to do that. You know, Tommy and I have been talking, and if there's time, see, the tough part about being on tour with the Ted Nugent Band, Styx, and REO is it's going to be really difficult to get a timing schedule that allows all of us to put on our best concert, our longest possible, most songs every night. So if we can wrangle a good balance between everybody getting maximum amount of time on stage, and maybe I'll come back and jam with Styx for an encore, maybe Tommy can come back and jam with me for an encore, I wouldn't put it past us. You know, we might even do some James Brown's and some Rolling Stone and Yardbird songs.
That'd be awesome. I want to make sure then when you're in Arizona next time, I want to make sure we get you in studio again. It's always great to talk with you, Ted. It's a pleasure, and I appreciate the time, and I can't wait to see you face-to-face again.
Well, back at you, Mike, and Godspeed to you all. Keep standing up for the self-evident truths that make this great country so great. A salute to Governor Brewer, a salute to Sheriff Joe Arpaio and all the great men and women of the Maricopa County Sheriff's Department, and you guys keep standing your ground there, and I'm with you all the way.
All right, thanks a lot. That is Ted Nugent, the man. Uncle Ted joins us for a few moments. We'll be back. Don't go away.
The Mike Broomhead Show, News Talk 550 KFYI.
KFYI.com.